all who made possible my sabbatical. A sabbatical is a time of rest, and I did rest much of the time in Lubbock on our back porch with a book, more than one book. There were days when I did nothing and accomplished absolutely nothing, and eventually I did not even feel guilty about that. Guilt part took a while. If there was a unifying theme or goal for this sabbatical, it was spending time with my family, often involving travel. In July, Kathy and I went to Chicago for a few days, and we did Ferris Bueller's Day Off, including two Chicago Cubs baseball games at Wrigley Field, the Art Institute, and the architectural tour floating down the Chicago River. Then in August, Mom and I went to the Sacramento area of California to spend time with her brother and his extended family, my aunt and uncle and cousins. And they always enjoy parading me around so their friends can hear me talk. Sometimes being translated. Then in late September, Kathy and I went to Spain and Portugal, and we went with Kathy's two sisters and brother-in-law. We were privileged to see Gaudí Sagrada Familia and the Picasso Museum in Barcelona, the Alhambra in Granada, as well as take a few different wine and tapas tours. And in late October, we went to the beautiful city of Charleston, South Carolina, with my brother Cliff and Shelley, and managed to try a different recipe for shrimp and grits nearly every day. I didn't know that you could have a whole cookbook with different recipes of shrimp and grits. Nothing but shrimp and grits. It's all right. Perhaps the highlight of the sabbatical was sitting on a dock at a small lake, south of Abilene, baiting hooks for our grandsons, James and Max. That's when I started losing track of the days. Not simply the date, but the days. Is it Wednesday? Friday. I do consider this sabbatical to be a gift, not so much something deserved, believe me, but something needed. Now I want to say a few words about sabbaticals in general, and I don't make these remarks to justify my own sabbatical, but rather to encourage congregations and clergy to make such provisions in your letters of agreement covenants. Truly, we clergy are privileged to do something with our lives that we are called to do. And not everyone is so fortunate. And we are privileged to be invited into your lives on your most joyous occasions, as well as your most vulnerable, poignant, and painful moments. It is a fulfilling and rewarding life if one is called to it, like any vocation or true calling. One of our priests remarked to me recently that polls show that clergy are the most fulfilled of all people by their vocation, but they are the second most stressed of all people behind air traffic controllers. Now, I'm not asking for sympathy. My father used to say where one can find sympathy, in the dictionary. Between a couple of other words that start with S. But priests and pastors don't turn off some internal pastoral care switch one day a week on their Sabbath. They love you and they care for you and they pray for you 24/7. Most clergy would not trade that privilege for anything. I'm not asking for sympathy, but I am asking and seeking sabbaticals for our priests who have served and led a congregation for 6 or 7 years. Besides, it is a good thing for clergy to know that the world will turn without them, and it's good for you to know it too. So the theme for this year's diocesan convention is On Fire, Fire with the Spirit. which does fall to mind the day of Pentecost. And last night we did have some fun with the flame-shaped hats that bishops wear during liturgies. At one moment there, when the hat was presented, I wondered if our fun, that's the hat there if you weren't here, I was wondering if our fun would be accompanied by lyrics like, "Come on, baby, light my fire," or better, "I fell into the burning ring of fire." Of course, it's not the bishops, it's not that the bishop came back from sabbatical all fired up, that is significant. It is significant that last night everyone was wearing a flame-shaped hat, a mitre, and the Episcopal Diocese of Fort Worth is on fire with the Spirit. And people have noticed that, ranging from your communities to your communities of faith to the wider church. I'm about to name some ways that the diocese has been recognized, but before I do, I want to make an important point. All the recognition that our diocese is receiving and all the funds that are coming our way, because of the work that is happening and the risks that you are taking day by day, week by week, month by month, year by year. Each and every one of our congregations has risked something new in the past couple of years. Some things have worked well, some things have not, but when they don't, we try again, we try something else. So in early February, we learned that the Executive Council of the Episcopal Church was having its winter meeting out here at the American Airlines Center. As is customary when they meet in a host city, I, as a bishop, received an invitation to make a presentation at dinner and to have some of my staff and clergy join me in the presentation. And this ignited, that's a good word, ignited, this ignited a conversation about how to best engage with the Executive Council regarding the good news of what the Diocese of Fort Worth is doing. So my amazing staff swung into high gear. Michelle, Tracy, and Katie artfully put together this thumb drive full of videos and documents telling the story of the continuing Diocese of Fort Worth. And they made a bookmark with a timeline of our story, very easy for everyone to get a picture of our story on this bookmark, including all the firsts since the reorganization of this diocese, things like the first woman ordained and the first church planted and so forth. And Canon Wagner went into grant writing mode to make a proposal, and Katie, who had previously served on that executive council, and Galen, together they hosted the council for dinner at their home the previous night, the preceding night. And finally, Corey Caves of St. Martin in the Fields and Mother Karen Califat of St. Luke's in the Meadow and Father Kevin Johnson of St. Albans and Canon Jan Wagner and I all together made a presentation. And I can report that the council was moved by the stories that we told about this diocese. When the Executive Council asked how they could help us, we were ready with an answer. We have congregations that are growing. Overall, this diocese grew by over 19% in communicant members and by nearly 12% in operating revenue during this 3-year span between 2013 and 2015. And we expressed a need for funds to help recruit more clergy to meet the demands of our growth. Our challenges are challenges of growth, not survival. We asked for $600,000 in grant funds, and they did not say no. What they said was this: "We want to do this. Let's figure it out." Following June, the Executive Council of the Episcopal Church in Minnesota, is that right? The meeting in Minnesota voted to support finding the funds for the full amount requested by the diocese. And they gave a $217,500 cash grant to to the Diocese of Fort Worth from the operating budget of the Episcopal Church. Then they asked the presiding bishop to help raise another $200,000 to $300,000. Some of this will be matching grants to be ready. And then they offered to help the diocese work with an advisory group on church planning to obtain a $100,000 grant toward another church plant in this diocese. It was a good day. Now, pulling together a lean grant proposal is always a challenge. It is part strategic alignment with the goals of the overall granting organization. The goals have to align with their goals. And part of it is throwing spaghetti at the wall to see what sticks. In the end, the Executive Council gave some grant designed to help us continue to grow. Some of these funds were designated to bring the salaries of two priests in our diocese from half-time to full-time. Mother Karen at St. Luke's in the Meadow and Father Kevin at St. Albans had left full-time positions for part-time positions here because they believed in the future of the congregations they were serving. These grant funds will bring their salaries to full-time level for 2 years. Some of these funds are designated for curacy positions to help our larger congregations increase clergy staffing in order to facilitate their growth and to train new clergy under the excellent leadership of experienced priests and pastors. The remainder of these funds are designated for a salary for a church planter to help jumpstart a new church plant. Now, having said all that, there's more. Beyond the support of the Executive Council on that day, in May it was announced that the Episcopal Church Building Fund would provide a $500,000 loan to Theater Arlington to help jumpstart their capital campaign. By way of reminder, the Episcopal Church Building Fund came to know this diocese better through a recasting program in which seven of our congregations participated for a full year a couple of years ago. They were inspired by the adventurous spirit of our congregations. So when they saw an opportunity to join together in ministry with Theater Arlington and St. Albans, renewing the heart of Arlington, they did something creative and outside the box that they've never done before. They made a loan to a nonprofit organization working together with a congregation. They did not make a loan to a congregation or a diocese. And then there's more. The entire Fort Worth East Deanery, which includes St. Stephen's and St. Martin in the Fields and St. Luke's and St. Albans. The deanery has come together to form a pantry, Four Saints Food Pantry, in an effort to provide food for hungry people in the Meadowbrook neighborhood, a food desert in the city of Fort Worth. They formed a board with members from all four of their congregations, and they have a special board member, too. See here. Okay. Annabelle Sauer, a Girl Scout from Troop 3012. Through Annabelle's efforts, Four Saints Food Pantry received a $500 grant from a local utility company. Annabelle and her Girl Scout troop leaders, Teresa Sauer and Janet Wagner, are here today. Prayers. Please stand. Good. And just recently, Four Saints Food Pantry also received a $20,000 grant from funds set aside by General Convention for Mission Enterprise Zones. Patty Callahan is president of the board of Four Saints Food Pantry, and she is the author of this winning grant. Patty is here today too. Patty. So the Diocese of Fort Worth is on the map in terms of being a place known for innovation and risk-taking adventures. We are bucking the trend, and we are growing. And people in our diocese are leading efforts that are building bridges between our diocese and our communities and our broader Episcopal Church. And I just want to name a few examples. Marty Faley, Daughters of the King at a national level, Scott McComas, Brotherhood of St. Andrews, Jackie Meeks, Providence 7 representative for Episcopal Church Women, Susan Kleinbecker, member of the Episcopal Communicators, Amy Haney, board member of the Episcopal Women's Caucus, Kathleen Wells, board member of the Seminary of the Southwest, and board member of Texas Impact, and more. David Madison, executive director of the Southwest Association of Episcopal Schools. Michelle Keene, vice president of BEST, BEST is Bishops Executive Secretaries Together. Janet Wagner, member of the advisory group on church planting, co-convener of the consultation. The consultation is a group of justice-related organizations in the church. Board member of the Episcopal Women's Conference, planning team member for Now What Symposium on Repurposing with the Episcopal Building Fund. I can probably go on and embarrass her. Katie Sherritt, president of the House of Deputies Council of Advice, task force on the Episcopacy, leader in Episcopal Communicators. Tracy Middleton, Young Deacons Task Force, and member of Episcopal Communicators. You are active and visible in, through, and beyond the church, and bucking the religious decline trend. You're growing. Now, last May, I attended commencement Seminary in Southwest in Austin. Andrew Ellison graduated that day, back here. Yes. At any rate, the Bishop of Chicago, Jeff Lee, preached at that event, and he said in the sermon that in Chicago they have some congregations and agencies that using this phrase, they are bucking the trend of religious decline, and they're thriving by several different measures. He says they defy easy categories, and he named a few. I'm sure there are more than a few, as Chicago is a thriving diocese. Bishop Lee says, what I cannot give you is some kind of formula that has been the magic key for their vitality. I've puzzled over it with my staff. What do they have in common? And the best we've been able to come up with is three things, he says. Number one, each of these is crystal clear about its identity. Within about 5 minutes of being with them, you pretty much know what they're about and what they focus on. The second thing is that these are places and people having conversations about the things that matter. Not wasting a lot of time on arguments about the color of the napkins. They value and foster conversations about life and death, serving and challenging injustice, and what it might mean to follow Christ in the office of a Tuesday morning. The third and most important thing, he says, is that these ministries have heart. Leaders at every level are all in. There is engagement. There is confidence in God. There is obvious joy. There is the unmistakable width of the gospel. The proclamation at the heart of each of these churches is the death-defeating love of God in Christ. Three things in common. three things that stand out. Each congregation has clarity about its identity, knowing who they are and what they're about. They tend to talk about the things that matter. This diocese is developing an identity rapidly. Not simply who we are not, but who we are. And every congregation has some sense of what you're about. More and more you're moving to number two, more and more you're talking about the things that matter. And it's true that Episcopalians are going to argue about the napkins. Getting the napkins right is an expression of hospitality. Make sure they're cloth. So I'd be less than honest if I didn't report that I hear a little of that. If it isn't the napkins, it's the vestments. But you are engaged in deep conversations about things that matter. Just look at the type of speakers you bring in for these diocesan workshops. And heart. God knows you have heart. Especially a heart for those on the margins. The world needs heart. That's not new. Jonathan Kozol, a sociologist, spent a decade with the children of the South Bronx neighborhood known for its poverty and its pollution and crime and a sense of despair. Three books came out of that experience two or three decades ago, all indicting society's neglect of children in our poorest neighborhoods. Kozol tells of an extended conversation with two little girls, one of them 11 years old, the other 8. Stephanie and Lucia. I remind you that this is a tough neighborhood, and here's the conversation as told by Jonathan Kozol. It says, when I asked Lucia what she loves most in the world, she says, I love my heart. She manages to get some reference to her heart, or to God's heart, or just the hearts in general, into a lot of conversations. How powerful is God, I ask. He replies, he's powerful enough to make hearts. God needs to make hearts, she told me firmly one day. Stephanie, the 11-year-old, also speaks of God's heart and her own heart. I asked her once what she believed would make the world better. What would make the world a better place? She replied, what would make the world better is God's heart. I know God's heart is already in the world, but I would like it if he would push the heart into it more. Not just halfway. Push it more. Kozol observes Stephanie's image, God's heart, sounds like a gigantic pump for circulation. And that push it more sounds like what a coach might say to an athlete. An effort to encourage him to do a better job. It sounds like a great prayer to me, he says, from a little girl who knows what the world needs. Well, most of these children in Kozol's study attended an after-school program at St. Anne's Episcopal Church in the Bronx. Many attended services on Sunday, some served as acolytes. And I wonder, maybe by participating in that liturgy, the Holy Eucharist, week after week, maybe that's how they came to intuit this Christian story so vividly. Maybe they came to intuit the meaning of this gigantic circulating pump that's circulating the blood of Christ through the living limbs of the body gathered every Sunday to receive from God's heart. And here's the rest, to push God's heart into the world. Yesterday's preacher, David, became an especially good friend of me. continuing diocese, both dioceses have suffered the grief of devastating division. Both dioceses have been involved in litigation. Both dioceses are participating in resurrection rather than trying to rebuild an old church, participating in resurrection. And in the midst of all this, and all the uncertainty, it's been David's constant message that in all circumstances, we need to be the church. I'm mindful that the same disciples who were all together in one place on the day of Pentecost, the same disciples who were filled with the Holy Spirit and on whom tongues rested, and tongues as a fire rested, were once hiding in a womb out of fear. This church is a resurrected body. As the story goes, like the rush of a violent wind and the tongues as a fire, the Holy Spirit is made manifest among and within the followers of the risen Christ. We tend to call this, as you heard Gary say yesterday, we call this the church's birthday. I think that the magnitude of its importance is described well in one of our Eucharistic prayers, actually the oldest Eucharistic prayer in our prayer book from Basil of the 4th century, Prayer D. It's older than 19. Right one. A portion of the prayer regarding our salvation history reads like this: "And that we might live no longer for ourselves, but for him who died and rose for us, he sent the Holy Spirit, his own first gift for those who believe, to complete his work in the world and to bring to fulfillment the sanctification of all." He sent the Holy Spirit to complete his work in and through the community of faith, the church. Now that means a lot of things, but one thing it describes is a high understanding of the church. It means the church participates in the work of the Spirit, has a role and responsibility in the reconciling work of Christ. That's how we might define high church theology. It's not minors. That's one thing. It also implies that the work of the Spirit is dynamic. This is not a static religion that happened a long time ago once upon a time. The Spirit did not stop acting in the world after the Bible was written or the creeds were confirmed. Rather, Christianity is a dynamic religion fueled by the Holy Spirit, who is both present and active here and now. And like wind and fire, the same Spirit can be spontaneous and elusive and unpredictable and powerful, just as the Spirit can be quiet as a whisper, a still small voice. But either way, like a wind that blows to the river, the Spirit is uncontrollable and untamable. I believe the same wind is blowing today, perhaps in a new way, not only in and through this diocese, and not only through the Episcopal Church, but throughout Christianity. And I know that may be surprising, that may be a surprising claim, given that fewer people are calling themselves Christian and many are wringing their hands over the decline in numbers and the loss of influence throughout Western civilization, and probably no Christian tradition in our time has escaped the pain of division. And yet many believe, and I believe too, that a new wind is blowing. And it cuts across all denominational boundaries. And whether we call this new day a reformation, a reformation, or an emerging church, or a metamorphosis, a changing form, whatever, it appears that a fundamental shift in our self-understanding is beginning to emerge. One way I've heard it described is this, and there are other ways, but one way is this: that Christianity is moving from presenting itself as a system of beliefs to presenting itself as a way of life. For people are hungry for more. People are starved for a new way of life, which leads to a sense of God's presence, a path which leads to the abundant life which Jesus promises, a path which leads to a sense of being alive. That's the shift we are seeing. And more Christians from every corner of the Christian tradition are returning to the ancient Christian practices which lead to life. We are moving from an emphasis on doctrine, however important, and believe me, I think it is, but we are moving from an emphasis on doctrine and returning to an emphasis on practice. Theologians such as Richard Rohr and Diana Butler Bass and Ryan McLaren and the late Phyllis Tickle are reminding us of our ancient practices, that Christianity in the beginning was a way, a path, a movement. If you're wondering what I mean by practice, think of it this way. This is one way of thinking about it, as exercise. Think of it as training. Brian McLaren says, practice may not make perfect, but it does make currently impossible things possible. The one who tries to run a marathon cannot do it, but the one who trains eventually can. Take, for example, a wonderfully gifted musician. We may experience her music as inspirational, if not transcendent or ecstatic. I suspect there are times when even the musician would agree that something glorious has filled her and her audience, and it is a pure gift. Practice alone will not earn that gift. By definition, we cannot earn a gift. But practice may be possible. Practice can make the gifts of patience and kindness and courage and forgiveness and inner peace possible. Practice can make the gift of an awareness of God's presence possible. Practice can make the gift of communion with God and one another possible. Like the rush of a violent wind, and with tongues as of fire, the Holy Spirit is moving in through God's church. Wind and fire, two images of the Holy Spirit. Two images used by Brian McLaren, who says this. Perhaps we could say, just as a piece of wood catches fire and placed with other burning logs, just as an iron rod in some way catches the heat and glow of fire when it is plunged into that, and just as a person who gets too close to a person with a cold catches first the germs and then the symptoms from his companion, then if we are plunged into God's light and heat long enough, if we stay close enough to God for long enough, close enough to breathe God's breath, then we will catch a case of God. The symptoms of what God has: love, joy, peace, patience, justice, purity, strength, vitality. The symptoms of what God has will be transferred to us, and we will be infected. Infected with God. And we could say that when we become infected, we also become carriers of health, carriers of healing, carriers of vitality and light and fire, so we can spread to others and perhaps cause a full-blown pandemic. Brian McLaren. and become carriers, spreading in others, causing a full-blown pandemic of God. Breathe on this breath of God. Breathe on this breath of God that we might be the church in all circumstances. Breathe on this breath of God that we might push your heart more into the world. Breathe on this breath of God that we might be on fire with the Spirit. I want you to know that I admire you. I respect you. I have affection for you. And I'm ready to serve and serve with you.